Good afternoon and welcome to the afternoon session on entrepreneurship and renewable energy. Renewable energy is the fastest growing source of power worldwide. Solar and wind are at the top. Biogas and biofuels are growing significantly as well. What's interesting to find out, I was reading a World Bank study estimated that between 2014 and 2024, $6.4 trillion will be invested in renewable energy. I think that represents a great opportunity for the renewables, and it's a great time to be in this space. With the climate treaty set to actually start here in November, I think this sector is positioned to do extremely well. We have a distinguished panel of experts that are in this area that will tell us more. I think there's some great opportunities, and I would love to hear about opportunities for Macedonia in this sector. So it is with great pleasure and honor to introduce Mihail Mizrahi. He is the Director of Entrepreneurship and Innovation Development from Azrieli College in Israel, a country that has truly distinguished itself, that is doing more with less than any other country in the world. So Mihail, the floor is yours. Thank you.
So, hello everybody. I want to thank the organizers of Macedonia 2025 for the privilege to represent the Israeli ecosystem here. It's been an honor and a privilege to take part. I'm going to focus on the importance of the ecosystem for startups and the main ingredients of it as I see it. And I'll be doing it by telling the story of A2B Startup Accelerator that we initiated and built. And I want to emphasize on why it should it be interest of you, because as said in the last session and in the session yesterday with the distinguished ambassador Jan, there's a great similarity between Macedonia and Israel. We are both small physically, in size, relatively young countries, young and small in terms of population, and many and multiple nationalities within. So I'm going to speak about of various examples that I have. I'm going to take two examples that I had personal experience with them, and I chose them to describe how usually the energy field that is conceived to be dominated by large corporation can benefit from early stage startups that can really give it a boost of innovation and new ideas. So I'll be speaking at first on the story of A2B Startup Accelerator. Working. Okay. So I run Department for Innovation and Entrepreneurship Development at Azrieli College of Engineering. I had an experience on building several startups. This one, for example, took algorithms out of astrophysics and biology and applied it over the stock market. I was a team member building geoenergy, clean energy company, and recently developed WonderTip Medical, which is a medical device, together with my team specialists. Since 2009, I'm working at the Azrieli College of Engineering, and in 2014, we established A2B Startup Accelerator. The Azrieli College is a Jerusalem college. We aim to provide an equal opportunity access to higher education in Jerusalem region. We 100% engineering, and we teach seven departments of engineering in our college, located in a very strategic place in Jerusalem. So, about A2B Startup Accelerator, the aim was to be a home to our students, our alumni, and people from Jerusalem and the area wanting to develop a technological idea into a startup company. And I don't know if you know, but the Startup Nation book that was discussed earlier speaks about, I'm gonna sum it in 3 points. We are first in the world in R&D spending globally, first in the world in number of startups outside the Silicon Valley, and first in the world in per capita VC investment. It was not a part of Jerusalem. Usually when you talk about the Startup Nation, you thought about Tel Aviv and the area. But something happened. The mayor of Jerusalem, which is an entrepreneur himself, did very well for himself and became the mayor. He designed clusters for the city. So his clusters were life sciences, tourism, but also some high-tech, no startups. Bottom up, the community of the startup ecosystem in Jerusalem said, why? Why is it so? We have every ingredient we need in order to develop a thriving community of a startup ecosystem. We have the governmental institutes. We have universities, mentors, service providers, large corporations, finance, and even events. So why don't we have an ecosystem here in Jerusalem? We created a board that is actually a non-profit organization, acts like a political lobby to push the mayor, to push the government in the right direction, and to give efforts, money, and create a real thriving ecosystem in Jerusalem. So the Made in JLM community is a non-profit organization supporting and connecting the Jerusalem startup ecosystem in the city. We took on our website a map, an active map. We mapped every startup in the city on the map. To begin with, we counted 37 startups in Jerusalem. 2 years after our actions, we have 579 startups in Jerusalem alone. We're talking only about pre-seed, very early stage startups, so huge success. We also created a calendar, so if I'm doing an event, I won't overlap on over somebody else's event, and we can collaborate together and make sure that we are filling the room and creating very exciting startup events. The Time magazine marked the 5 emerging tech hubs around the world. He put Jerusalem in first place. And this is not because only of the community coming bottom up. It's also because of the help of the municipality, the help of the government, and the support they are giving the ecosystem. We had Mr. Bloomberg coming to the city, taking a photo with our picture, saying, Jerusalem might be the next best thing. And Startup Campus marked us at the 30% best city hubs for developing your startup in. Our goal is to be on top 20 cities in the world by the year 2020. So where is A2B fits in all of this? So in the end of 2014, we established the accelerator. We chose 7 companies. Our acceleration round is half a year, which is, in Israeli term, a very long period of time. Usually accelerators in Israel is 3 to 4 months, but we are an engineering accelerator. It means that we only help engineering ideas related to one of our 7 departments of engineering. So we do not believe that you can realize an engineering idea within 3 months or get results within 3 months. So we extended a little bit the period of acceleration of our program. We give our acceleration 4 different tools. So the first one is the co-working space. Usually accelerator use the hot share system. It means that you come with your own laptop, sitting in a chair. Tomorrow somebody else is gonna replace your place. You replace you and sit in your chair. we are handing out real offices to the startups. So nobody's gonna come and sit in your chair. You can leave your computers, you can leave your equipment, your workers, your interns, your slippers, and they do, and use the office as your own. On top of that, we are providing, like any other accelerator, a 6 months unique program. In this 6 months, we teach them everything they need to know in order to develop a technological idea into a startup company. How to do the global market research, how to create a go-to-market plan, how to create a business plan, how to do all the boring legal stuff like contracts and IP and so on. They get also an opportunity to meet entrepreneurs that already sold one or two companies and ask them very hard questions in an eye-level conversation and not in an auditorium. The third help that we are giving them, I think, is the most significant. They get full academic support. Whatever we have in the college is for their disposal. They can use anything they want. They can print anything in 3D. Use any reactor, use the wind tunnels, meet any professor, take any academic course. They can even get interns to work for them instead of doing their internship in Intel or in Teva or in somewhere else. So they get a lot of help, they get a lot of engineers without paying any money. The fourth help is the help of our partners. We gathered over 30 international and local companies to give packages of help to each and every one of our startups in each and every one of rounds. And we have, for example, Microsoft is giving $100,000 for each and every one of the companies in Azure computing with all the software of Microsoft free of charge, and Indiegogo, Deloitte, Dale Carnegie, the biggest bank in Israel, lots and lots of help. In terms of statistics, we have 200 accelerators PRESID exist in Israel. One in every 10 companies is raising money, the PRESID very minimal amount to start with. In our accelerators, out of 7 companies in the first round, 5 of them raised $22.5 million. In the second round, we just finished it right now, out of the 7 companies, half of them raised a little shy than $1 million. So we are considered to be a success. I'm skipping because we don't have any, we have very little time, but we opened, because of our relative success, an accelerator in Germany called Accelerator Frankfurt. It's located in Frankfurt and dealing only with fintech and cybersecurity. We wrote a program together with the German team. We are helping the UN build a chain of accelerators in Africa. The first one is going to be in Kiambo, nearby the capital of Kenya. And we're working very closely with Innovation Warehouse. This is a very special event called the London Bridge. I don't have time to elaborate, but I'll speak about it later on. We are hosting delegations from all over the world coming to see how we can create young employment and how can we help young startups to do it. I'm gonna go very, very briefly because I don't have enough time, but these are two case studies on how can renewable energy startups be of help of the industry and of the economy. So geoenergy is using actually a practical, very old idea, just renovating it a little bit and pushing it forward. Israel is a hot state, air conditioning is a must, and it's very expensive, and it's very hard to push heat from this room, for example, outside to a hot atmosphere. What this system does is taking the heat and burying it in the ground. It's very logic to understand it. If you go to a cave in the summer, it's very chilly. If you go in the winter, it's very hot. So we use this concept, but we can't do it in the most known way and distribute the heat on the ground because we don't have real estate. It's a state, it's a small country. So we did two things. We used very sophisticated drilling instead of horizontally, vertically, and we used software to optimize the system. So we can do lots of creative things to use this energy in a smart way. For example, at night, electricity is very cheap. I can take the heat from the ground and throw it in the air. By morning, I have a frozen ground and I can air condition the room almost for free. So these are some of the manipulations that you used to do. And this is another idea. This company is dealing with autonomous drones. I know they thought to begin with agriculture, but in the end, they decided to work with energy fields and with security. So if you need to monitor this energy field, you need a drone that can fly autonomously. You don't need to use any remote control. It goes by GPS. The thing is with the drones is the battery life. The battery life can last 15 minutes at most. So what they developed is a docking station for the drone. The drone is scanning the mirrors, the field of the energy field, running out of battery, going back to the docking station to recharge, and then starting over from the same spot. So this team created this solution. We're going to see it working in a security promises, but it's the same way with the energy fields. So this is the docking station already functioning and working. The drone is flying autonomously. Nobody flies it. It goes automatically to a place. In this case, it's a security promises. Nobody controls the drone. It's only sending data. You can see the map. You can see the live streaming and also the thermal screening. And it follows anything unusual on ground. For example, it detects a person. And when it detects a person, it's not only detecting, it's also automatically following him. So auto detect and follow. It can also take the pictures and follow the security team when needed. After finishing the mission, it autonomously go to the docking station, recharging and sending sending all the data automatically. So you can see the landing, and when the light changes to a red light, you know the drone completed the mission and now is autonomously recharged. This is a small example on how you can take technology in 6 months and create a real product, working product for the industry. I'll be answering questions, but if anyone wants to develop the ecosystem here in Macedonia, we will be more than happy to help. I'll be the last person leaving this room. Thank you very much.
That was amazing, amazing stuff. Thank you so much, and we'll definitely take you up on that. A lot of learning there. Thank you.
Dobar dan. Dolazim iz Hrvatske. Inače sam iz Zagreba, živim I radim u Austriji već godinama. Ovo je za početak, a sad ću na engleski, radi drugih moram na engleski, koji su zaboravili svoj materinji jezik. So, everybody, hello, I am coming from Croatia, from the mining industry. I'm tall, play basketball before many years, so now I'm old star, not any star. I get a scholarship during my studying, and I went to Atlanta. I played for Atlanta Hawks for the junior team. And after that, when I come back, my mother said to me, if you don't want to study, you will be a garbage man. Now I am in the garbage, working. I finished mining industry. I understand the mineral oil industry, gas industry, all this big interest. And I need to tell you something. First of all, I forgot this. Ricardo, Biljana, Vase, Jadran, Jadonka, Jadran, Erdanka, Maja, Brendan, I svi ovi ostali, puno hvala. And thank you very much for this excellent organization. And best regards to my Kirill, friend from Vienna. I think you will pass this message to him. I'm honored to be here. And now about the garbage. I start in the mining industry. Was invited from General Electric by the gas engines using the all kind of gases coming out from the mining, from the drilling of the oil, using boil off gases and everything. And then suddenly come one guy from the company from Austria and tell me, do you want to be in the biofuels? I told him, hey, sorry, I am from the mineral oil industry. Yes, you understand this part of the world, we need somebody who will take care about future. And this is a future I recognize through this company, and I am now passing through all development, all departments of this company, and now I am responsible for the whole world. But I start also to work on the South-Southeast Europe. Slovenia, Croatia, Serbia, Macedonia, Albania, Bulgaria, Romania, including Turkey, including Cyprus. And if you go over the border from Austria outside and you travel southly, you will find only garbage. On the streets, in the household, and nobody take care. Nobody take care about the future, nobody take care about our children, nobody take care about the money, what is in the garbage. Nowadays, after 6-7 years, you have companies that are very rich. They take advantage, they recognize that this garbage can be something valuable. Now you have a plastic going not only to the plastic industry to recycle in the new bottle, they recycle in the building additives. You have RDF, you have all kind of waste streams that you can make money with this. What we are doing as a company, we have more than 125 people in the BDI concern, in the total company around 600 people. We invite students, we invite people that are coming from the schools. We give them opportunity to take this knowledge from us and to spread it down all over their friends. So please, all companies that are here in Macedonia, give to the young people opportunity to come and to learn. Give them 1 month to be on the project. Give them 2 months to be on the project. They will develop themselves here, not outside of the Macedonia. You don't have a problem of immigration to some other countries. If you want to invest here, then invest in the young people. What we have a biogas, we have a biodiesel, we have a retrofit. It's existing plants that we build all over the world. It's more than 40, with a capacity of 100,000 tons of production of biodiesel. We have also BioLife. It's a company that we build now. It's a factory that produces one small particle for the cosmetic industry from algae. Financially, we are a very, very well company, owned privately and listed on the stock exchange market. But actually, we will go from this stock exchange market, because every 3 months you need to put numbers, you need to have a clear picture, you need to give everything to the competitors, and then you are not as strong. They know how you deal it. Short overview about the project. We have a lot of projects, but I choose this one because this is the first one in the world. This is made with the Heineken brewery. And the waste that coming out after the production gives to the brewery opportunity to make themselves independent from the energy. So they produce with the waste electrical energy and heat energy. I don't want to give you every chemical details, but if you see this, that the spent grains and the yeast, you can use it, and you have only 20 kilograms per hectoliter produce beer. And if you have 1 million hectoliter beer, then you can have a 15 kilowatt hours per hectoliter produced from this waste. What was the challenge? The challenge was the production of the beer. They produce the beer from Monday to Friday, and then they go home. The brewery is closed Saturday and Sunday, so you don't have a production. They don't take this waste, produced energy. We store this for the Monday, and then we start into the real production on the Monday. This was the beginning, so they use natural gas for the cooking the beer, and after the implementing of the waste anaerobic digester system, where we produce biogas, they have completely independent supply of energy through the biogas. And this is the first in the world now. We are working with the Heineken, we are working with the AB InBev, with Submiller, with all big players, and they are now interesting to implement this kind of plant in their own breweries. The breweries we choose, it's around 400 in the world, capacity from 1 million hectoliter to 20 and 50 million hectoliters. Why spent grains? Somebody will ask me, we use these spent grains for the feeding the animal. So meat production in Europe goes down. I eat here last night Argentinian steak, and I asked the cook, where is coming from? You don't have production of the meat in Macedonia. We in Croatia, we don't have also. We closed down around 800 cow facilities that farmers are having. In Austria, they are closing down if they don't have more than 100 cows in their production. This is first problem. The second problem is that you will find all kind of energy resources, not only in this area. You can start from your graveyard and clean it. But for this, you can use this biogas. I will not go in this deeply in this for upgrading, for putting into the grid, for the vehicles, for all kind of technologies, and you can use this as a clean energy. We have a project 15 years ago in town Graz. We collect used cooking oil, we produce biodiesel, and buses, public transport, use this for a transport. Okay, Graz stinks like a McDonald's, but the children are happy. So I wish you also that you learn something from this conference and from this summit. I invite you all, young people, to take a chance. Please, as a professor from Japan said, we are now in the ship. But I think that you need leaders to not be sinking ship. I think I said okay this on English. And I will go home with this sentence. When I speak about Macedonia, I will speak with love. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Robert. Thank you. We have trash in Macedonia. Do you think you can help us make money from our trash here?
So I didn't take opportunity to get this information on the stage, but we are in the let's say negotiations with a Skopska brewery. We are a company that we will build and operate, so they don't need to have a budget for this because they're in the Heineken group. I hope that we will succeed. depend on the brewery also, not only on us, depend on the Heineken group. We have also experience in the biodiesel. We know everything about Mac Petrol and all these guys from Hellenic and from biodiesel production. We know that you have a collection of the used cooking oil also in Macedonia and also in Skopje, but only one company. They are reselling this for 600 euro per ton. They are collecting for 20 euro per ton. This is the truth. You have also plastic collectors. They are collecting for the cheap money here and reselling for the very, very big revenue. But for all projects that you want to establish in Macedonia, the same situation is also in Croatia last 10 years. We didn't move forward because of no support from the government, no support from the political institution, no support from the European Union, because if you start to ask them for the money, they will act like today or yesterday, these guys from the banks. Yeah, yeah, we have something, we will do this, we will do this, but the risk of this investment in these countries, it's amazing big for them. They want to have a lot of securities, mostly they're asking money from you, in most cases. Okay. So this is the future. Fight for this, fight, be fast, and try to secure security for these international investments funds or banks.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, my fellow Macedonians, it is a great pleasure and honor for me to be here today with you. And first, I want to congratulate the Macedonia2025 team for this great event and for the great organization. Congratulations. And let me tell you a few words about myself. I'm Mihail Mateski. I'm from Skopje. I'm a master of mechanical engineering from the University in Skopje. And in 2002, I moved first to Novi Sad in Serbia to establish, together with my partners, a plastic packaging production company. And later in that year, I moved to Romania, where I spent the next couple of years where I established, together with the partners, GreenTech is the pioneer and the first recycler of PET bottles in Romania and also in the region. Later on, I moved back to Novi Sad, to Serbia, to Skopje, and since last year, I'm also resident of Toronto. So you can find me from Skopje, Novi Sad, in Toronto. And as Hrvoje said, I'm also dealing with the waste in my business. But to get the proper message, I have to use a common expression that we had in our ex-Yugoslavian countries. And I have to say, ja sam svoju sreću našao u smeću. So, unfortunately, I cannot have the proper translation in English, but okay, most of you understood. So, let me start with introduction of the company. I'm a general manager and a co-owner of GreenTech Macedonia and Serbia, and we are working as part of a green group of companies. Green group today, we have 14 years of history, starting from zero in the plastic recycling, and today we have operations in 5 countries. We are running 8 plants. We have almost 2,000 employees, and last year, turnover was 89.5 million euros. We have production sites with factories in Romania, in Serbia, in Macedonia, and we have our trading offices in Germany and Greece, and from next year we will have an operational trading office in Toronto. Besides plastic recycling, in Romania, Green Group is dealing with recycling of other materials as well, like glass, like electronic waste, like batteries, lights, etc. GreenTech, our first and startup company, today is the number one recycler in East Europe of PET bottles, and with the ongoing investments, next year we'll become number one in Europe. On the photos, you can see some of the lines. The first one is one of the 8 lines of recycling of PET bottles. The next one is production of PET strap. And the third one is production of rPET granules, which are used for production of new bottles, means bottle-to-bottle technology. Today, GreenTech in Romania has 680 employees, 21 million investment, and the highest capacity of recycling of 130,000 tons of bottles per year. Green Fiber is the largest company in Green Group and is the, today, second largest producer of polyester fibers made from 100% recycled bottles. And also, like GreenTech, from next year, Green Fiber becomes number one producer of recycled polyester fiber in Europe. This is the overview of the company. It was established in 2005 in Romania. The investment so far is 25 million euro. We have 500 employees. Last year, turnover was 63 million euro. The present processing capacity is 54,000 tons. And next year, with the fourth plant, we'll reach 85,000 tons. On the photo in the middle, you can see how a polyester staple fiber looks. And in the bottom line, you can see the industries which are the main user of such fibers. The largest one is automotive industry. The second one is the hygiene products. And the next are the geotextiles, the membranes, the filtration and stuffing of different products. Our main market is EU. We are present with clients in most of them. And here are the logos of some of the top clients for Green Fiber. GreenTech Macedonia and Serbia. I will start with Macedonia. We are here since 2007. Next year, we are celebrating 10 years anniversary of operations in Macedonia. The factory is located in Gazela premises, the industrial park in the east side of the city. We have 52 employees. The investment is 1 million, and this year we will have about 2.5 million euro of turnover. In Serbia, we have established the company in 2005. Now we have 153 employees. The investment is around 3.6 million euro so far, and we are further investing. This year we will reach around 5.7 million euro turnover. And we have there two production lines. One is for recycling of PET bottles, and the other one is for recycling of film, polyethylene film. On the photos are shown the building, the factory's building, and some of the lines. As technology, we are using the top brands in the world in our industry. For the hot wash, we are using Sorema technology from Italy. For the optical sorters, Pelenk from France, S plus S from Germany, and Bühler from Switzerland. While for the film recycling, we are using KS from Taiwan. And for the wastewater treatment, we are using Italian technology. What I have shown you just as a brief, to give you an idea that even in Southeast Europe, you can build up a company in a relatively short period of 14 years, and you can become a European leader, which is the... Thank you. Which is a result of a dedicated team of people who knew what they want to achieve, and we are really doing our best every year. But to move forward and to develop more, we cannot do the business on our own, because environment is always very much in relation to the authorities, to the local authorities, to the government, and to all citizens. What is important to know is what are the trends of the collection. Despite representing the source of our collected quantities, it represents Serbian market, but it can be considered as an overall picture of the region in Southeast Europe. Unfortunately for us, the biggest slice, 45%, the blue piece of the pie, is coming from the waste pickers, and you can see them every day on the street. We are not happy very much that this is the system that we are relying on, and we are trying to get involved and to support, but this is a complex issue that has to be addressed on a country level, involving different ministries, different participants. The red one is the one that we are always appreciating the most. This is the selective collection from the households. The following chart represents the recycling and collection rate of PET bottles in 2015. What is important to know is the yellow bar is representing the quantities that we have succeeded to collect and recycle in Serbia, which are 33% of the quantities placed on the market. In the same time, the red column is showing that the industry has capacity of 66%, meaning we as an industry, besides GreenTech, there are other two companies recyclers in Serbia, we can recycle almost double from the quantities which are collected so far. So the problem is in the collection. The technology for recycling and for processing exists and the capacities exist. And unfortunately for us, the blue one, the dark blue one, represents that the national target is only 14%, meaning less than half of what we are collecting as a national target only. So in order to address this problem, we as an industry, we have proposed to the Serbian Environmental Ministry a four-year plan how to increase the collected quantities and with a certain social, economic, and environmental impact. Our proposal was the rates of collection that we are already doing to be in line with the national targets. This would bring in the period from 2017 to 2020 the following results. It would bring, I will just pass through faster in order to have more time for the discussion later. It would increase a 5,000 tons increase of the collected quantities, creating 770 new jobs in our industry. The actual number is 2,000, and we should reach to 2,770. The increased revenues in the industry would be around 3 million euro on the top of the existing 8, so we should reach somewhere around 11 million euro. And we should save additional 250,000 cubic meters of landfilling. And landfilling is something that we really need to think about, because we heard a lot of lectures also yesterday. We are talking about circular economy now in European countries. And in Macedonia, we are still kind of building the first sanitary landfill, kind of making a concession, it's going for years and we didn't reach anywhere. So it's an unfortunate story, but this is our reality. The future development of GreenTech in Serbia and Macedonia is the following. We are planning to implement intelligent on smart or smart collection systems. I will address this a little bit later. Multi-material collection, besides PET, we will deal also with aluminium cans and glass packaging. We want to improve the separate collection infrastructure, increasing the national recycling targets, regional sorting station, minimizing landfilling, and increasing public awareness. But what should we do? What should we do today? What should we do tomorrow and here? And the change has to start from each and every one of us. Unfortunately, we have always nice guests coming from abroad to Macedonia, and they are always delighted by our great and lovely country, and is really one of the most beautiful in the world. But we also know very well that we have a lot of garbage everywhere. And if we want to preserve the nature, if we want to have healthy food, organic food, this is something that we have to do, but it has to be done by us. So I will ask now a question to the audience. If you have the possibility to recycle at your households, some of you, I already know the one from abroad, would you recycle at home? And please raise your hands if you had the access. So almost everybody. And now for the Macedonian part of the audit. Of the audience, how many of you have really access to such an infrastructure, meaning separate bins for collection or separate bag to select by the utility company? Anybody? Only one or two. So this is the real picture, unfortunately, in our country. People would like to, but unfortunately, they cannot at the moment. So the message that I want to deliver today to you is we are the ones who need to make the change. Change the habit, stop littering, and start recycling. We cannot behave, it's important only what is in our home. Once you exit, you don't care. No, you really need to care. Because that waste is a resource for an industry like the one that I'm representing, the green recycling industry. So what we want to see is to engage people and make recycling cool. Like it's becoming cool to drive a bike to work, etc. Recycling needs to be also cool, which is already in most of the European countries. We want incentives for the citizens which recycle, meaning they should pay less fee on the waste disposal bill. We want to implement eco tax on landfilling, because unfortunately in Macedonia, the utility companies are charged only with 15 to 20 euro per ton to landfill, which is very cheap, and it doesn't bring additional push to them to make recycling. We need to put environmental protection high on the political agenda, especially in the local elections. We don't see, if you don't count the Green Party in Macedonia, Dom, I don't see on their agenda that environment is a hot topic or somewhere up. This is what we need to do if we want to go on the right direction. So the message is, let's make our country green. So, and I will take, thank you. And I will take just a minute more from your time. So the new reality is the following. We have seen these smart solutions and smart technologies. Yeah, it exists also in our case. Since last year, we have already implemented this SICUREC, Innovative Collection Infrastructure, or Smart Collection Infrastructure in Romania. These are photos. You have indoor and outdoor reverse vending machines, mobile stations by trucks, and they're offering digital transparency and control, safe transport, and they're engaging people, meaning the people who will bring the waste are rewarded by voucher, and this voucher they can spend in the retailer. So it's not a deposit system, it's a voluntary system that we can do. And the system is also implemented based on a mobile application, which is also engaging people. Each individual will have his own personal recycler profile. He can demand, or usually this is for business to business, on-demand collection service. You can calculate and you will receive a calculation of the CO2 emission that you have saved by collecting and by recycling. And you can also do competition prices, and you can also donate the voucher, the value of the voucher, to somebody else. So that was the last one. I'm looking forward to your questions later on, and also in the afternoon and in the evening. Thank you.
Thank you, Mihail. I agree. Let's make Macedonia green. The sooner the better. All right, the next segment, since this panel and we're talking about entrepreneurship and innovation, and that was a great example of what is good for the environment, it's good for business, and it's good for us. There's three products that we have that are made right here in Macedonia that embody that very, very well. They're good for our health, they're good for the environment, and they're great for business as well. So we're going to start off with Izaac to tell us about his water.
Hi, everyone. So I hope everyone's been keeping hydrated at this event. It's my job to make sure the bottles that are graced on the table are consumed. If not, you may want to just open up a bottle right now, because I just want to actually raise a toast to Macedonia 2025 and all their great work and hard efforts and continued growth here for Macedonia. So as you know, my name's Izaac Trpeski. I am the CEO and founder of Oro Luxury Water. So my presentation today may be a little bit unconventional or unorthodox, because it is more about brand building, but I will touch on certain points as well as renewable energy and water resources as well. Some of you probably are thinking, why another water brand? Well, I'm here to convince you the exact opposite, as well as educate you on why exactly no two waters are the same, and that water isn't just water. You know, the Oro Luxury Water brand was created in a response to a gap in the market to produce a premium functional water brand that possessed great unique qualities such as rare carbonation and super high mineral content. So this is just a snapshot of our brand timeline to date. I just want to talk very briefly about that. So our water is 8,000 years vintage. That is a little bit of a marketing spill, but it actually takes a very, very long time for the water to seep down into our artesian aquifer. Geographically, the region of the Oro source was used as a trade route in historical times as well. So that is another beautiful piece of marketing that we actually like to go with as well. In 2015, so we are a startup. In 2015, we did launch in the Australian market. Now, a lot of well-known brands use Australia as a platform to introduce new brands. And we thought we'd take that model, and it seemed to work quite successfully. Also in 2015, we did enter the HoReCa market in hotels, restaurants, cafes, premium health stores, grocers, and so on and so forth. 2016, this year, we ended up taking out the world's best naturally carbonated mineral water at the International Fine Waters Tasting Competition, which was held in Guangzhou. I'll talk a little bit more about that later on. We've also started exporting out to China and Korea this year. So by the end of this year, there is also big interest to export to places like Macau, Hong Kong, Russia and Italy. Italy is a little bit of an interesting one because they're part of the EU and they have their own rules and regulations, which we're still trying to understand, but we will get there. And furthermore, for next year, we're looking at North American, Japanese, UAE, and possibly Israeli market too. So just a little bit about the Oro source and its origins. So it's on the slope of the Kozyak Mountain, as you can see up there on the screen. So it's within the Macedonian Alps, as we like to call it. In an ecologically clean environment, completely untouched by man. The water itself is actually filled about 200 metres below the earth, so it's quite a fair distance. Our big competitors here. So our USP, what makes Oro so unique? Well, yeah, Oro has 310 milligrams of magnesium. Not too sure how many people actually take magnesium supplements themselves, but magnesium is great for a number of different things, for the human body, including relieving muscle cramps, bones, digestion, stress, anxiety, many things. Actually, probably over 200 bodily functions that it's good for. So it's quite a super mineral, if you like. You know, our bodies are quite deficient in magnesium themselves due to the soils and therefore food being depleted in our soil. So we're missing that vital mineral. Oro, I guess, allows people to get their recommended daily intake. And the daily intake is about 320 milligrams for humans, which we almost have, and it's fantastic. Just a little bit about our award as well during this year. So we were highly privileged to be awarded the gold medal for the world's best naturally sparkling mineral water, which was a pretty big effort. Thank you. So there were some well-renowned judges. We call them water sommeliers. So there are wine sommeliers, of course. Now there's a few water sommeliers, whereby they judge a water on clarity and smell, taste, mouthfeel, very similar to wine. So I'm just going to quickly, because I know we're sort of running short on time, I'm just going to flick through some slides. So just bear with me. Yeah, through our business model, our goal is to make Oro a global brand. So, and it's also a matter of putting Macedonia on the map at the same time. Our strategy with that is to work from the outside in rather than working from Macedonia and out. So it's a unique strategy. No one's doing it, but we hope that it will be successful. So just some points on our vision and values. So as our company is, its aim is to actually educate people about water and the fact that no two waters are alike. Yeah, it's important to understand the mineral content of water, but we also teach people how to drink our water and how to pair it with wines and food. So again, it's a new market, it's a premium bottled water market, and this is the direction that we're going into. A little bit about water etiquette itself. Different bottled waters, I guess, give different experiences, especially when they're paired with certain foods and wines. So yeah, we want to encourage people to look at water like they do wine. I think it's something that's been missing. Water is actually the most important beverage us humans should be drinking, yet it's not valued enough. So just some quick points on the premium bottled water market as well. So it's the fastest growing drink sector globally, surprising or not, well surpassing soft drinks, of course. This is a result of people moving away from sugary drinks, you know, in the wake of obesity and the diabetes epidemic. So as you can see here, it says 5% of the market share globally. It might not seem like a lot, but in my next slide, you'll understand the figures. And they're missing. They're quite small. So according to Zenith International, worldwide sales of premium bottled water have exceeded to 10.6 billion litres by the end of this year, taking its overall retail value to more than $15 billion a year. And that'll increase to about 12 billion litres in 2020. So the global bottled water market is... which does include premium bottled water itself, is about $157 billion, and that's massive. So if we can get a small slice of that, that'll be wonderful. So other notable regions which we're focusing on more is the Asia Pacific. We feel that's the fastest growing. As you can see, Asia Pacific, 17%. Of compound annual growth rate. So that's amazing, it's astonishing. I think within 5 years, we're gonna see China particularly overtake areas like Western Europe or even North America. Just quickly on natural resources, I know we're running short. You know, water as you know it is quite a precious resource, but our water supplies are very, very limited. So 97.5% of the Earth's water is salty. Only 2.5% is fresh water, so a very small amount. Over two-thirds of this fresh water, you know, it's locked in polar ice caps or glaciers. So it only leaves a very small amount of 0.5% in our lakes, rivers and underground for agricultural use, industrial use and personal consumption. Due to pollution, of course, places like China, you know, felt it. The quality of the water is definitely under threat. Now, according to the World Health Organization, only 0.007% of the world's total water supply is safe for human consumption, so that's a very small amount. So there's about 7 billion people on this planet, as we know. And the fresh drinking water isn't distributed evenly. You know, there's countries around the world and regions which are quite scarce in water. So about 102 billion people live in areas of scarcity. They include areas such as southwestern United States, India, Spain, North Africa, even Australia, where we're from, and northern China. So just talk a little bit about renewable energies. In regards to the renewable energies, I think Macedonia can possibly do a lot here and add to you know, a bit of value here because it has an abundance of water. It's probably, you know, the oil of this country. You know, there's so much of it, and the quality is fantastic. So it can be known as a, you know, globally as a green and an eco-friendly country. So we need to sort of promote that, and we try and do that within our brand. So as we grow, our operations are also exploring opportunities to develop these renewable energies, such as, you know, possibly wind and solar. Being a small operation, we're not using any of these facilities, but we know that expanding within time, we'll definitely start exploring these ideas. So some other initiatives include optimizing energy efficiency of our plant, and that could be increasing our line productivity, investing in more energy efficient machinery and heat recovery, and also just gaining important knowledge and expertise from gentlemen that are sitting, you know, right beside me here, and also in the water industry and community itself. So just giving back to Macedonia, I was born in Australia, but yeah, my roots and my heritage run deep, and the idea was to always do something here. And traveling here for many years, it was always said to me that, you know, Macedonia has such great water, and you really should do something with it. So I had that from relatives and friends, and it took a while. It took a few years to actually delve into that and explore it some more. But meeting the right people and you know, having the right networks was such a paramount, you know, to make this a reality and an execution. So it's about just, you know, being proud of these roots and you know, giving something back. So my dealings with Macedonian trade and business has been very positive, and we've been fortunate enough to have, you know, the right guidance, and, you know, with our partner company Trading with Macedonia, who works and acts as Oro's export and logistic partner, you know, we're able to provide a good quality and strong product, and hopefully grow with that in the future. So just lastly, I hope you've had a little bit of insight. I've had to cut this a little bit short, but, you know, there are some recent successes that we've had. We have big plans for the future, and, you know, this is the fastest business sector globally, so just watch this space. Thank you very much, and long live you.
Thank you, Izaac, and congratulations again on your gold medal. And this is the best way to take magnesium, so this is wonderful. Thank you. I'd like to just take a moment right now and to tell you about another product from Macedonia that is good for you, that is good for the environment, that is good for business. And unfortunately, the brain behind the product was not able to be with us, but her husband will say a few words to tell us about a product made in Macedonia.
Thank you, Vera. My name is Guru Bonavar. I'm the husband of Nevenka Dimitrova, who is on the board of Macedonia 2025, who was unfortunately not able to be here. I'll just take a minute. So Nevenka is a computational biologist, genomics specialist by day, and at night, she is a vegetarian, vegan food enthusiast like myself. I would like to take this opportunity just to introduce to you a company called Seed of Life, a local company that she started just a year or two ago. And we've had a tremendous amount of support from the local community here. This company manufactures totally organic, vegan, raw food right here in Macedonia, actually about 100 kilometers from here, in a town called Negotino, that many of you know about. And it looks like this. It's in your delegate packet. You can try it out right now. And I think you'll see that it is not only really healthy, it is also very delicious. And I would have to say it's not only good for the body and for the business, for the environment, it's also good for your soul. And I would like to say that this is a brand new food group. It's called Raw Food, where we use low temperatures and we preserve some of the key ingredients in there, such as omega-3 and vitamins and enzymes that are actually incredible for your metabolism and other processes in your body. And we're not only using these local ingredients like seeds and nuts and spices, we are also employing local people at all levels of skills. And I'd like to just highlight here that Sofia Shutova, who is right there, is our local manager here. And she is, stand up, please. And she is just building a distribution network here locally in Macedonia and in the Balkans, but also she's looking to export. So if you have any help to offer, please contact Sofia. Thank you very much again.
You're welcome. Thank you so much. Great. The product stays delicious. They're wonderful. Thank you. And I want to tell you a little bit about a product that is very close and dear to my heart, and that is the Aveda Comforting Tea. This product has been made in Macedonia since 2003. That's when it was launched. It's grown tenfold. It is sold worldwide, and it's produced right here by Alkaloid. Right here in Skopje. And here's a perfect example to kind of sum up everything that this panel is all about: entrepreneurship, innovation, and sustainability. So here's a product that is made with 100% certified organic materials that are great for you, that are grown organically, which is great for the environment, and it's wonderful for business as well. So thank you so much. I want to thank my panelists. Wonderful presentations to all of you. Thank you. We've covered everything from renewables to organic food to production in Macedonia. I'd like to open up the floor to questions, please. Any questions? Yes. Slavica?
I would like, first of all, to thank the panelists. This session was most interesting. I enjoyed it very much. I enjoyed every single one session.
Thank you.
I'm pleased to hear that in Macedonia you already started with using alternative energy by recycling some of the unwanted products. I believe that is in Kumanovo. But now I have a question for Mr. Milosevic. I have a question for Mr. Milosevic. You mentioned that Austria, in Graz, you're using your buses are running on biodiesel. Can you tell us what is the percentage of biodiesel in Austria that you produced, you used, and do you export any of that?
The numbers that you have in Austria, it's around 250,000 tons of production. One, it's in Vienna, the biggest one, it's 140,000 tons of biodiesel plant directly connected to the OMV, and blended and mixed it into the existing diesel around 10%. So what they are exported around Europe, I don't know the numbers, I need to ask them directly and then I can inform you, but the consumption of diesel in Austria, it's around 400,000 tons.
Is it a law in Austria where you must include certain percentage of biodiesel with your regular diesel when you're mixing it up?
Yes, just to tell you just like this shortly, but actually in European law it's written that every country in Europe needs to mix and blend biodiesel into the diesel. But every country has their own laws and every country make their own laws. So we in Croatia we have only 2%, and then 5%, and then 7% in 25% maybe. And this is the reason because of mineral oil industry. Because if you take 1% of this big business, it's let's say on this way 400,000 tons of biodiesel. If you take 2%, it's 800,000 tons of biodiesel, and 1 ton of biodiesel is 1,000 euro. And the mineral oil industry don't want to give this 1%. Of the money, let's say on this way.
Thank you very much.
Thank you all for the excellent presentations and for sharing with us the success stories. Just keep up the good work. My question goes to Mihail Mateski. And actually, it's more than a question, it's a constatation. I have a feeling that the preparedness of citizens to recycle is on a much higher level than the preparedness of the companies in the recycling business to invest in recycling rates. You mentioned yourself that almost 50% of the sources of recycling plastic actually comes from waste pickers. And in a way, it's good because it provides them financial means for living. But on the other hand, it doesn't provide a broad spectrum of possibilities for the regular citizenry to recycle. So just a question that always occurs to me when I come to Macedonia. Why you simply do not have standard, simple, cheap vendor machines in any supermarket where you can charge one denar per each aluminum can or plastic bottle to buy the product, and you will be paid back two denars, for example, when you bring back the bottle for recycling. I mean, you mentioned that you invest in some vendors, in some voucher schemes, but all of that seems so complicated and unnecessary, according to me. I guess you should make it and keep it simple and keep it available to all the potential users of the recycling services and just marketing it. Because I doubt that anybody would refuse to recycle if he has the possibility to do it in Ramstore, in Vera, or in Tinex, or in any other supermarket which is close to his house. Thank you.
Yeah, so is it a question that I need to answer, or is just your...
Well, you may understand it as an intervention. I understand that the first 15 years, it's always difficult for a company. It's a period when you have to try to stay on your feet. And it's a period when you try to get the investment back. But again, social responsibility should also be coming from the companies themselves, and especially in regions such as the Western Balkans.
So let me explain a little bit deeper. The only country in the region of Southeast Europe that has a model of deposit is Croatia. And in Croatia, the state is running the system, meaning the state has invested a lot of money in these reverse vending machines and in collection centers. And then the local companies are doing the operational part of the business, meaning collecting, sorting, and further delivering to the recyclers. So what you mentioned is a different system and different law. In Macedonia, we have primary collection, bins, and green dot system. So we are talking about different systems of solutions. Just as an idea, one RVM machine can cost between 10 to 30,000 euros. So to place, for example, like 1,000 machines in Macedonia, to have it more or less in every supermarket means like several tens of millions of euro. So that's why it's a costly system to implement at the beginning. But on long term, it's beneficial. So I agree that on long term, it should be done. But it has to go from the state and each stakeholders, because the recycling industry itself, it cannot support it. It has to be also the fillers, also the citizens and the retailers. So I hope I made it a little bit clear. Thank you.
I just want to make some, like in Hrvatski Sabor, ispravak krivog navoda. In Croatia, we don't have established company. It's a private entity, and they're fighting in Croatia with laws and with everything, but they are collecting, but it's not supported. We have big companies from Europe, they are coming, they want to invest, and something in the procedure goes wrong. I was involved 10 years ago into the separation units and dumping the garbage into the landfill. We have a strategy and we have everything, but it's not supported. The big companies like Saubermacher from Austria or Asa or Veolia, or you will find here maybe some trials from other big companies, Remondis or somebody, who are big players in the world and also in Europe. They are not coming in this area because they are not supported from the law. And everybody thinks why they can take this waste, because for us it's also the money. So we'll find the private entities, they are running for the waste and selling to the European Union. So this is the truth.
Thank you. Any other questions?
Hi. First of all, I want to congratulate you, Mr. Mateski, on your work. When you asked the question, if anyone had a chance to recycle, they all raised their hand. They said, yeah, we will do that if you have a chance. I'm sorry, but I have to disagree. Near the place that I live in, we do have a chance to separate waste from plastic. And in the last 2 or 3 years, I have seen not a single person does that. So my question now is, what in your opinion is essential in order to change people's mindsets? And how can we in Macedonia convince the people that recycling is a way of living and that if we don't continue doing that, we'll end up with nothing? Thank you.
I'm sorry, but you know there is a strange sound. So it's can you just repeat it, the last part of the question?
Okay, so is it okay?
Yeah.
Everyone said that if they have a chance to recycle, they will do it. And then in my opinion and in my experience, near the place I live in, we do have a chance to do it. And I have seen no one till now separate plastic from other waste. So my question is, how can we convince Macedonians that recycling is a way of living and how to change people's mindsets? Thank you.
Yeah, so I don't know if you noticed in my presentation, public awareness campaigns is very important. So it's not just you place a separate collection bin and then the bottles or the other material will end up. So it's very important, and that's why I say it's different stakeholders. Also the state has to support educational campaigns, starting with the children in the schools, but also for all citizens. So this is the way to do it. And it has to be a campaign all the time. You don't give up. So as we have seen a lot of campaigns on the media supported by the government for education, for safe employment, buying houses, etc., recycling should be also one of it. Because if you address it, people will know it and then they will do it. But if you just, you know, skip it, then forget it. And you also know that most of the collection part is done by the utility companies, which in our case are publicly owned companies and are not the best model of efficient business, you know. So this is another issue that needs to be addressed. So, but continuous public awareness campaigns is something that needs to be done, and then the mindset will be changed and everybody can do it.
One more question.
Yes.
But before I go there, you know, I live in the United States and I used to be a horrible recycler. So let's just say that. So it's no difference, I don't think. Most people are lazy and they don't want to recycle. It's easier to dump your stuff wherever it is and pack it out. But I think what we moved to another town in Connecticut, and what the town did was they changed the way they recycle. And I think it improved the amount of recyclability actually quite a bit. And actually, I know we as a family now are much better recyclers. So what they did was, instead of us doing the selection, they just make us put all the stuff that we think potentially is recyclable in a separate bin, and then they do the separation. So you don't have to do the paper yourself, you don't have to do the bottles yourself, you just dump it in a huge bin and they figure it out. And I think they put their processes at the separation facility, so it's not on the citizen, and it made it easy for me. So I think we as a family now are better recyclers just because we don't think about it. But that's just one reply, because I think people make this notion of Macedonians, Americans are also lazy, I think Europeans are also lazy. You just have to make it convenient for people. But one question for the three entrepreneurs. How did you guys get your companies started? From a financing standpoint, who funded your companies? And then two, just very quickly, short answers. And then the third one is, and the second question is, how did you decide to be more expert focused versus domestically focused?
What was the last one, sorry?
How did you decide to focus your companies more for export versus domestic market?
Sure. So our company is 100% self-funded, so there's no external investors. Look, as we grow, this is something that potentially down the track we will have to look at. So big markets like China, look, it can either grow organically on its own, or you know, you might need some backing. So we're 3 months into the Chinese and Korean market. Right now, it's not a necessity to ask for that sort of investment. But down the track, definitely places like America, even Europe, we're going to have to increase with that funding. Why the outside market rather than the domestic? Well, quite simple, really. Saturated market here in Macedonia. There's a lot of water brands. For us, it was a different strategy. It was more about a brand building exercise and work, like I said, working from the outside in. We think this is a better strategy. We think it's a better strategy as well in terms of putting Macedonia on the map, getting it known. One of the problems we had when we first started in Australia was that there were actually no people that knew about Macedonia, had never heard of the name. So for us, this was a bit of a challenge, you know. And then when you enter restaurants, for instance, that are run by Italians, and, you know, the Italians are very big, in, as we know, into their sparkling water brands, it was a little bit difficult for us. But I want to just tell you a little bit about the name Oro as well. And it has dual meaning. And this is a clever marketing tactic. My background is advertising, so it did seem to help. Oro, as we know, in Macedonia, it means to dance in a circle. So that's one meaning. We wanted to encapsulate that and keep it. You know, just have some connection with that cultural root. In Italian, it means gold. So when we do enter the Italian restaurants, they automatically change over. Because of, obviously, the awards we're winning now, but because of the name. So it actually resonates with their clientele.
And you have a gold medal for the gold water.
Exactly, yes.
So in our case, the beginning was we were private investors, a group of private investors that we initiated the business. But at a certain point, we realized that if we want to grow further, we couldn't do it with only our resources and some bank funding. So eventually, we sold the majority to an equity fund. 5 years ago, it was a global finance from Athens, together with EBRD. This year, they sold their shares, and now, today, Green Group is 80% owned by equity fund Abris from Warsaw. And the plan, after 5 years, the plan is to go to either Warsaw Stock Exchange or to London Stock Exchange. So this is the direction. Otherwise, you cannot grow. We couldn't achieve those results if we didn't have the sufficient funding. And regarding the export orientation, well, simply, for the final products that we are producing, the biggest consumers are highly industrialized countries, which is not the case of Southeast Europe. So for us, EU countries was a must because they are the huge consumers of those kind of recycled products. That's simply.
Being personally also involved in the waste streams or living a waste life, to say it, I was attending a conference recently in Berlin on electronics goes green, and recycled plastics was one of the biggest topics that was being discussed. So we were hearing from different sides, for example, the recyclers, they were saying that they are producing too many recycled plastics and nobody is buying it. On the other side, the electronic producers were saying that there's not enough plastics on the market. So I wonder, what is your position on that? Do you have enough buyers or you have overproduction?
Yeah, so it's different types of plastic that I use. So for the packaging plastic like us, we are using polymers. It's PET or polyethylene or polypropylene. So while the electronics is going with technical plastics like ABS, polycarbonate, etc. So when they're discussing about shortages or extract volumes, is different types of plastics. How we are solving the problem is indeed, in the past years, especially with the drop of crude oil price, because PET and the polymers are derivatives from the crude oil, the low oil price affected very low virgin material prices. So the end users, at the moment, they don't have too much reasons to use recycled material if there is not a difference in the price. So in our case, we solved the issue, we went further downstream, meaning we are producing fibers, we are producing strapping, we are producing granules bottle to bottle. So practically, we are going deeper in the market and trying to find niches of markets where we can sell our product. So this is it. And for the electric electronics, it's an issue that in our countries especially, it's still very low rate of collection of electric and electronic waste. If it would be done properly, there will be sufficient plastics, also of this kind of technical plastics. Thank you.
Great. Thank you so much. Thank you, panelists.